हेलो, कैन यू हियर मी? हेलो, या एम आई ऑडिबल? ओके ओके कूल, लेट्स वेट फॉर अनदर 5 to 10 मिनट्स, लेट एवरीवन जॉइन। टिल देन कैन यू गाइस टेल हाउ मच आर यू फैमिलियर विद फ्लास्क एंड हाउ गुड आर यू एट इट? लाइक डिड यू बिल्ड एनीथिंग और नॉट जस्ट इन फ्लास्क बट एनी फ्रेमवर्क इन जनरल? Okay, intermediate, that's good. This is going to be useful for both beginners as well as intermediate people. I'll be talking about how the framework works basically and how you can take it to the next level, you know, build real world applications and collaboration with different people. I'll be talking about everything. Hello Kapil. Yeah, even if you don't work, did not work with Flask, that's okay. I'll be covering from the basics, as you can see in the documentation page. So that's not a problem. Just stick with me. If you want, till then, I have shared my slides in the description. You can go through them. I'll explain them in a bit, but if you want, you can go through them and see what I'm going to cover. Yeah, the session will be recorded. It will be stored in YouTube, so don't worry about it. But if you want to have any live discussion, now would be a better time for that. Sorry about that. Yeah, I guess we have enough people to start, I think. Shall we start? Yeah. Let's start. More people are coming, that's why I'm waiting for another 2 minutes. Okay, fine. Let's start then. Okay, cool. And don't call me sir, I'm still a student. Okay, so basically, even if you know Flask or not, or framework in general, framework is just like a template way which would help you to build any software that you want to do. Like TensorFlow is a framework for machine learning. So Flask is a framework for web development in Python. Okay, about me, basically, I'm a third year undergraduate student at CBIT. Yes, I will also talk about advantages of Flask over Django, definitely. First, let me introduce myself and get it over with. I'm a third year undergraduate student, as you can see. I'm an open source contributor. I've been doing this for the past 2 years. So by doing that, I got to know about how different people collaborate and how to build a proper application, and my interests are web development and machine learning. And apart from that, that's it about me. The topics covered today are, I will give you a basic introduction about Flask and how to install it, how to do what is a virtual environment and how it is going to help you in the future, and show you how CRUD operations work, basically what are CRUD operations and how it is done properly, and also talk about how the application be deployed in any of the various resources that we have, and also talk about open source contributions, specifically for Flask projects that you can do so you can get better and know about what real world standards are right now, and talk to different people about it. Okay, coming to Flask framework, now I will cover about that. Correct. Okay, we use Flask to Flask can be used to host machine learning models, but that's one use case of it. It is a general web development framework. It usually deals with the backend part of the development, but yeah, you can deploy your trained models, and it is easier to deploy if you use Flask or any Python related framework. And coming to the advantages of Flask over Django, as someone asked, Flask is light. Like only a piece of code is required for you to just get it started with. You don't need extra packages or extra dependencies for that. We just need a Python, that's it. Python and virtual environments, I guess. That's it. You don't have to worry about any other things. And it is very much customizable to your needs. So as I told you, Flask is light because it doesn't give you anything to get started with. It gives it has a concept of extensions. I'll talk about it soon. So what it does is you'll be able to add whatever feature you want in whichever particular language you want to the framework. For example, let's go with databases. There are many databases, right? SQLite, Postgres, MySQL. So Flask has a different extension for it. Actually, the only extension like Flask actually gives a layer over it, over the databases. So you don't have to deal with the SQL commands which are in the low level. So you just have to enclose them in classes and objects, and you can directly deal with them in the high level. I'll talk about it later. That's one use case of it. And scalable, as I told you, many open source projects use Flask as their server and web development framework. So it is highly scalable, and it is an open source project itself. So if you go to GitHub, let me show you. Here's my mouse. Yeah. If you go to GitHub and search for Flask, it is an open source framework itself and is done by thousands of people around the world, as you can see. So the app is easy, like the support is very much there from the community whenever you need. Apart from that, as I told you, huge support is there for it. Whenever you're stuck at something, you can ask many people around the world, even though there may not be any person that you know who knows about Flask, you can ask anyone around the world about it. Yes, that's it about Flask. If you have any more questions general to Flask or how to get started, kindly ask them. I will address that also. Coming to CRUD operations, okay, before CRUD operations, let's just show you how light Flask is, right? I'll show you how easy Flask is and what is a virtual environment. I'll cover these two topics now. Before that, if you have any questions, kindly ask them. I'll answer them. Just create a new folder. I'll be creating a very sample like direct app. P1, I'll keep it P1. Right? So if I'll just move into that folder and I'll create a app.py file. Yeah. So this is the app.py file. You can just go to the Flask documentation, right? It has tutorial part. It talks about project layout. All the Flask tutorials, also the official Flask tutorial, is also very good. You can follow it if you want. As you can see, this 4-5 lines of code is there, right? Just copy them, paste them here. This is a hello world program in Flask. It will run in your local host, right? So save it, close it. Now I'll be talking about virtual environments. Let me deactivate it first. Okay, so I just created this app.py file. As you can see, in this we have the 5 lines of code that we copied, right? After this, generally, whenever you develop any application, you have to have many dependencies. It requires some packages that you have to install. For example, in JavaScript frameworks, you need npm to install yours. So similarly, in Python, you should have pip. It is a package installer for Python, basically. And the concept of virtual environment comes when you are building any application which is related to Python, be it a machine learning application or a web development application, your wish. It is really good practice to create a virtual environment. So I'll tell you why. So for example, this is my pip. If you say pip freeze, as you can see, here it is written as base, right? That's because we are not in any virtual environment. Now if you type pip freeze, you will see these all are the packages, Python packages that are installed in my computer. See, there are too many. The problem comes when you have different versions for different applications, right? For example, you have already built an application that uses a Flask, let's say 0.8. Now the current version is 1.1 or something. So there might be some conflicts. This is just the main package I'm talking about. There are many sub packages, as you can see. So maintaining a virtual environment helps everyone. Basically, it helps you a lot, not everyone. So this command I've typed, this is the Python 3 version of the virtual environment command. The Python 2 version is different, and also this, I think this command works only in Linux and Mac OS. In Windows it might slightly vary a little bit. Okay, so Python mvnv, first venv is for virtual environment, second venv is the name of the virtual environment. So second venv can be changed to anything as per your wish. Now if you type source venv bin activate, if you type this, as you can see, it changed from base to venv. Now we are in virtual environment. How can we can check it out by again typing the same command, and you can see nothing came out because there's nothing in it. It creates a, as the name suggests, it creates a virtual environment inside the folder. So all the packages related to that web applications will be stored in that folder itself. Now just install Flask. It's simple command, pip install Flask. As you can see, Flask is installed. Clear it. Now as already know, we have app.py and virtual environment folder in our p1 project, sample project. So you can just type Flask run. Oh sorry, I'm using it already here. Let's stop it. Okay, yeah, let's type Flask run. Flask run command starts the application. Now it runs in your localhost 5000. So that's just direct port number. Yeah, this is the Hello World program. As you can see, this is the Hello World program. It's just 5 lines of code. It doesn't depend on anything. You don't need anything to deploy it. To run it. So that's the basic introduction about, Flask and virtual environments. I hope you find it useful. Yeah, I think this covers the introduction to Flask. If you have any questions anywhere, post it, comment it down. I'll clear them. Okay, so, and to come out of the virtual environment, you have to type deactivate. Remember this. See, as if after this, the virtual environment is gone. So you can type pip freeze again to check out. They're back, many of them. So yeah, that's it. So this covers the introduction to Flask, and I hope I covered why is it better than Django. It's not actually better than Django. The use case is different. Flask is light, and it doesn't give you anything to begin with. It's just 5 lines of code and you have to customize it on your own. Django comes with a more solid structure where you can build it yourself, but you have to follow more rules in Django. Django is more scalable than Flask. Many big corporations use Django. Yep, so that covers the Flask framework, I guess. Next, CRUD operations. Why I choose to do CRUD operations, by the way, CRUD operations means create, read, update and delete. So yeah, why I choose to do CRUD operations, because in any framework, if you learn about CRUD operations, you will be able to do all of the other things very easily. It will be very spontaneous to you, because CRUD operations involves connecting to database, retrieving data, how to interact between the front end and back end. All these things will be covered in CRUD by doing this CRUD operations. So I will go through them. Yeah. Okay. So coming to CRUD operations, this will be my folder. Yeah. Okay, first, yeah, this is gone. So I'll show you the structure of my project first so that you'll understand what is going on. Right? So the basic CRUD operation, this CRUD application has is a app folder, basic app folder. This is a folder where you store everything about the app, like all the routes. I'll tell about each of those in detail, but it contains the routes, the models, the forms, and the templates. Everything that is required for an application to be stored in an app folder inside the main folder. Flask CRUD is the main folder of the project. Inside that, you'll have an app folder. After that, migrations, I'll tell about it a little bit later. Static folder has all the CSS, JavaScript, your photos, and everything. These are all in the top level of your application. And even your virtual environment obviously will be there here. Okay. As you can see, I'm already in my virtual environment. So coming to my, I'll start my application. Yeah. So I'm starting my application again. Now this time the CRUD application will be started. So if you reload it, okay. Sorry, I did not add any time to actually add more CSS to it. So ignore the front end part. I just did whatever I could to make it colorful. Okay. So yeah, these are the posts that are created here. So this CRUD application basically creates, reads, updates, and deletes a post. As you can see, here are all the posts that are created till now. This is the first post, and this is the second post. And if you type edit or delete, you'll be able to delete this post or edit this post. For example, if I click delete, this post is gone. Post has been deleted, right? So this is a delete operation. Update operation comes when you edit it. First, let's create an application. I'll show you with respect to code so that you'll understand what is going on in an easy way. So if you see, this is the create form. Okay, let me just give another overview of how the application is structured so that you'll understand. Any application is generally structured in MVC or MTC architecture. Okay, model, template, control. Okay, template basically it is the front end of your application, basically the HTML code of your application. What you see this side, this is the template part, the HTML part, and whatever you type in this, and that goes to the back end, right? That back end part will be stored, the structure of the back end part will be stored in models. And whatever you see in the URL, I hope this is visible. Whatever you see in the URL, this is the main domain name. So CU is for create and update. So if you click this, it will come here. If you click this, it will come here. If you go back, it's create a CRUD app. Yeah. So this is the front end part. I'll show the template for it. CU.html, right? See, this is the front end. Basically, let me wait. I'll pull it a little bit. Yeah, can you see it? I hope everyone can see it. Is the text too small? Let me know. So yeah, as you can see, CU.html is for create update. This form here, many concepts come into picture, like how the Flask is useful. You'll get to know it here. So as you can see, extends base.html is the first line of code. So what is this? It actually means instead of our regular HTML and whatever we do, extends help us to use the same piece of HTML code over and over again. We don't have to write it again and again. We'll be able to use the same template or the base As you can see, this is the base. This is the normal HTML code, as anybody can recognize, would recognize. It's a normal HTML code, right? Head, CSS. Yeah, this part I'll tell you later. I'll tell you in a minute. But this is the basic HTML code, right? The HTML starting tag is starting and ending it here. So this provides the basic structure to your web application. Like, for example, if you have a navigation bar, right? The navigation bar. Okay. Yeah. How much HTML CSS should be known while learning Flask? It's actually very minimal. As you can see, I did not use very much CSS or HTML here. These are basic HTML tags, very basic. If you don't know them, you can Google it out for that instance and add it. So you don't have to go in deep for HTML or CSS or JavaScript for that matter to learn Flask. Flask is a very learn it separately. You can just Google it out when you know. Which is more scalable, Flask or Django? For learning, Flask would be much easier than Django. Scalable, Django is more scalable. Django is more scalable because it has more predefined structure. From what I know, that is what I know. Django has a more structure, so it is easier to scale it. But both are, these days, due to cloud platforms, I think both are easily scalable. Yeah, so that is that. And where am I? Yeah, this is the basic structure. And yeah, so whatever these white thing present in curly brackets, this is one of the Flask features. This is called Jinja 2. It helps you to Jinja 2, right? It helps you to basically type some logical statements in HTML. As you all know, HTML is just a representation language, right? Hypertext markup language. It is a markup language. So to add some dynamic statements to it, like if statements, control statements, for loop, while loop, something like that, you can use these. Yeah, for example, curly brackets and a percentile symbol shows a conditional statement. It also shows the loops, for loops or while loops. Anything can be shown in the curly brackets and percentile sign. If you use two curly brackets, then it is a variable that you pass. I'll talk about it later. So that is what here. So as you can see, the title of the web page is create post CRUD app, right? But what is written here is title CRUD app. So the title part is the dynamic part here, which I pass when I load the web page. I'll talk about it. Okay. So this is the title part, and coming to body. This is the coming to body. This is the CRUD app pad and everything. Yeah, you won't be having anything related to the form here. As you can see, the form part is not written here. Only the base structure is written here. From where I started, cu.html, that this message is there, right? Yeah. Block content and block. This is where your code will be added. When it is rendered, your code from here, the whole part, this part till here, it will be added in this one single piece of code. So you don't have to have this huge pages of code. You can separate them based on your functions, right? That is the template inheritance. A feature of Flask, one of the good features in Flask. It helps you to reduce a lot of code. Yeah, and coming to the shall I go with form? Okay, this is the template side of the code. So this is the front end, as I told you. If you go to routes.py, this is actually the traffic controller. You can say he's the traffic controller of your whole website, right? He'll tell you where this file tells you where to go, which web page to go, and which file to load, and when to commit to the database and everything. As you can see, we are in the create form database, create form site, right? Let's type some TV show or movie name, any movie name. For example, Friends, right? Everybody loves Friends. Right? If I submit, as you can see, the post is created. What happens in the backend is actually this. So, whenever you click the submit button here, as you can see, this is the form that we just filled, right? Whenever you click the submit button here, form.submit, as you all know, the form is not our typical form here. Only the form tag will be there, and the internal things will be related to the Flask. I'll tell you about it. So as we fill this form and press the submit button, the actual processing part is done by routes. Okay, so whenever you click the create function will be called. As you can see, this decorator is there, right? This thing is called the decorator. This line of code @app.route is called the decorator, and it tells the route at which the route at which this particular piece of code should run, right? So at cu/cu, this piece of code runs. What it does is it creates a form.post form, right? This is the form that we are talking about. It creates that form and it validates that form. It has inbuilt validation functions. This part is when you submit the submit button, when you click the submit button. This is the logical part which runs when you click the submit button in Flask, in this form. But what actually is rendered in this template is this part: return render template cu.html title create post. As I told you, title, right? In base.html we just saw this variable title is replaced with create post, as you can see here, create post. So that is the dynamic part I was talking about. And yeah, you have to pass these variables in any order you wish, of your choice, and these will be rendered there. You can use these values there to show some dynamism, like if statements, or showing some the title, as you can see, something like that. So the template cu.html is rendered. After that, this is the first part of the code. So cu.html is first rendered. After that, when you click the submit button, again it comes back here, and it then validates your code, like the data that you sent, and then it creates a post model. What we are talking here is a post model. Before that, should I talk about the form? Okay, I'll talk about the form first before the model. So form, you should actually have to create the form in forms.py. So as I told you, I'll talk through my coding. Yep, I'll do that. As you can see, this part, this is the form part, right? This is an extension, one of the extensions of that Flask has. I'll show you that also, what extension it is, right? See, as you can see, there are many types of it. Usually extensions are flask dash the extension name. It can be anything. So in flask, there's this thing called flask WTF, which gives you the, which basically gives you the ability to create forms in your flask application. You don't have to depend on HTML, as I told you. You don't need HTML or JavaScript here. Yeah, let me see where is flask. I'm unable to see, but yeah, you just have to pip install. This is one of the extensions, flask WTF. Yeah, successfully install flask and flask WTF. Okay, yeah, these two are the flask extensions for forms specifically. As you can see, we first have to create a form that we want to show in the front end. This is the base part of how the form should structure, right? So for example, the title part is a text area field. This is the label of the title, as you can see here. As you can see here, it comes here, the title, and the validators are the inbuilt validators, like data is required. So if you just click submit button, it will say fill out this form, and this doesn't require any JavaScript. So this is all flask specific code, right? So this is the flask part of the form part of the code. And coming to the models, so for every form that you create, models and forms go in hand to hand. Like for every form you create, right, this is the post form. You have to create a post model for that. Like this data that you sent through form, it will be stored in a post model in your database. So ID will be auto generated. It's the primary key and it's auto generated. It will be incremental, as you can see. Let us go back. See, this is the first one. If you create another one, this will be third one. Okay, this was the second one, and this will be the third one, because it will be incremental, right? So this is the model, and this is the title. This is the model part of the code. Model basically means the what you want to store in the database. Like it is a table. In a relational DBMS, you can say that a model is a table basically, and the primary key is the ID here, and the other parameters are title, body, and timestamp when it is created, right? This defines the structure of the table, basically speaking. So the form and table will be connected. It will be connected in routes. The form and the table will be connected in routes. As you can see, form equal to post form. This creates the form that we want, and that will be shown. That form is passed to cu.html. Right, if you go to cu.html, that form is only used to create the structure that we want, structure like this. So as you can see, form.title.label, that form.title.label comes from the form file, like where we define the title, right? See, this is the label that we are accessing here. Form.title.label means the title will come here, right? So that's how it goes on when you first load the page. Route is actually handling everything. Routes.py folder file will be handling everything. And the second part is the columns and rows. This is just a text field that you text field size basically, and the same thing is here. And if you get any errors, while filling the form, it will be shown in red color below the text box. I didn't keep any validators here, so there won't be any errors. But yeah, if you, for example, if for an email part, if you type something without, like without a @ symbol, an error will be produced. So that's that's the basic form part of it, creating a form, how it works and everything. Okay, when we go back to the routes.py, first, as you can see, form is created, then the form is rendered, the form is passed, and it is rendered in cu.html file, right? When you click the submit button, right, when you click this button in cu.html, again it comes back to the create function, but here, as you can see, form.validate.submit, this is when on submit we are validating basically. So when you click submit button, as the method is post, as the method we defined is post here, form method, that will be the methods which we are accepting are post and get. So if we, for example, remove this part, right, save it, and one more thing, what happened? Distribution not form. Distribution is not found and is required by Alembic. Okay. Acha. It's saying SQL Alchemy is not found. So. Should work. I don't know why this error is coming. Let's keep it in full screen and see. Yeah, you have to get used to this type of big errors, right? It always like there will be a difference in Python version. For example, you can see it is accessing a Python 2.7 distribution of the code. So these things happen a lot of times. Don't get frustrated. What did I do to make this happen? Distribution not found. Okay. Why isn't it coming? Okay, address already in use. Yeah, this is one more error that I get always, like instead of pressing Control C, I press Control K in when I want to stop the server. This kind of it doesn't stop the server. No, it's pip3. Yeah, I did use pip3 the first time. See, I use the pip3 only. That's not the problem. So, as you can see, yeah, the address port is already in use. So, quick trick I can give you right now is the 5000 port is in use, right? So, if you click this, if you type, it should work. List of pip is pointing to one which comes with bugs. Yeah. Okay, let's type as you told. See, I did type this. Let me Google it. I forgot the command. yeah, it also happens in Django as well. So yeah, this command lsofi should kill it. When I do it, most probably it should. Now what's the problem here? Less off. Wait, let me see. Unknown protocol name, support number. Okay, let's just kill the TCP 5000 here. No, that is also not working actually. I usually do it by lsof command only. It lists all the processes that use 5000 port. Did it in medium. Okay, let's just search the error. Unacceptable port. Okay, wait. Google the account. Socket number already in use. Yeah. Yep. Kill these functions. Which one should I kill? 41842. I guess I killed it. Without space. No. Well, wait, I have another copy. Good thing I have another copy. Yes, this is another copy. I'll figure that bug out later. Right, the socket is in use, right? Where should I tell? Like, I'll export the port number, I'll change the port number. Okay, you mean these are. Okay, I deleted this one. Oh, sorry about that, bro. Yeah, it was already running. I'm an idiot. I just got to know that. Yep, everything's working, guys. I'm sorry for wasting your time. Yeah, let's get back to the code. I hope I'm not too slow. If you want me to speed it up, kindly tell me, okay? Yeah, it is working. Everything was working. It was my mistake. Sorry about that. So where was I? Yeah, as you can see, this part comes into picture, and the post function is called, the post model is called, and the title of the post model comes from the form, and the body comes from the form, and it is stored in the database. DB session add post, DB session commit. Right. So your post is now live. Yeah, whenever you create that flash message is something which just comes once, and it is a temporary message. It will go away whenever you do something. It will go away. So this is the basic create what goes in the framework when you create a what you call a post or any operation. When you create any operation, this is what goes. You have to create a model for backend part. For the DB part, you have to create a model, and you have to create a form which replicates the model parameters. And the route handles all the template, which template to load, which model to call, which template to load like here, and which model to call from here, which form to call from here, and which model to call. And db.session.add is the command to add it to the session. When you commit it, it will be stored in the database. DB comes from the what you call it, SQL Alchemy part. So I'll show you that part as well. So the way you structure your Flask application is also important. It is not always like this. Some people directly use app.py. I kept app in app.py, and I kept another folder called init.py where all the initializations and everything is done. Basically, this sometimes this can be like, it can be empty, so that you know, you just have to tell that it is a package. Like this folder is a package. Folder is called a package if you have a file called init.py, that is a Python thing. So as you can see, this is where everything is initialized, all the commands, the Flask main app command, and app.config from object config. This is configuration part. I'll tell you about it. So the DB part, as you can see, is come from the SQL Alchemy part. SQL Alchemy is, let me show you what SQL Alchemy is. So this is another feature of Flask. One is in template inheritance, as I told you, and another one is SQL Alchemy, right? It's basically a, you know, high level language for your database. It just maps all the database statements that you have. So for example, create table, table name and everything. Those are the basic commands that we learned, right? So what if those commands become very big, right? If you're dealing with 100 different parameters, and you want different types of different variations in them, you can't just write each parameter name that you want, right? This helps you ease the task a little bit. So that is this. That's SQL Alchemy. And migrate, I'll talk about migrate also later. So that is the SQL Alchemy part. Coming to the configuration, this is where you have to keep all the configurations required, or all the global variables that are needed for the application to run. For example, as you can see, secret key is it's required for safety of your application, basically, from various attacks, various cyber attacks. It helps you be safe from them. And SQL Alchemy database URI, as I told you, there are many different types of databases that can be used for Flask. Here I'm using the default SQLite part, but you can use Postgres SQL. For production code, you have to use a better, more scalable database like Postgres or MySQL, anything that is better than SQLite. As you know, SQL uses disk-based storage, which is not that helpful in production. And SQL Alchemy track modifications, this part is not needed for now. So post per page, I kept 3 here, right? So if you create another post, what happened? Method not allowed. Method is not allowed for this request. Okay, I did change something. Yeah, why is it not working then? Okay, let's go to here. It's working. Yep, method not allowed. Okay, 405 is something with the related to form errors basically. I don't know why this part broke, but yeah. Anyway, coming back. Yeah. So where was I? I was telling the configurations, right? Yeah. So post per page, I kept 3 here. So as you can see, this defines the number of posts in page. Like it gives the pagination to your website. For example, if you go and reload this page, only 2 pages will be there. So what happens is that, as you can see, this is the main part of the code. And when you go to the Explore tab, only 2 posts will be visible per page. This is what happens when you decrease the number of posts in a page. Basically, if you increase it to 4, something happened here. Method not allowed. Well, some method not found error is I'm getting. Should I go with the flow or solve this bug? You know, I'll be wasting your time again. Better go with the flow. Okay, already I have 2 posts, so I can show you the edit and delete part as well. So yeah, this controls the number of posts and it gives the pagination, or you know, it gives the pagination part to your code basically. Like page number 1, these many posts, page number 2, these many posts, something like that. Okay, now coming to the, that covers, I guess that gives you whole picture of how create is, create. Okay, I'll do the full screen. This is better, right? So, yeah. This is the, this, I think this covers the create part and route part, you know, what happens and what happens inside. And I also told you about, oh yeah, thanks bro, I just forgot about it. I forgot it in the flow. This method is not allowed, post method is not allowed, obviously. Let's go to routes. Yeah. So somehow I proved it again. You guys are solving my problems. Thank you for that. Hope I'm helping you. So now it should work. Not sticking to this one. It's not coming again. I don't know why. Wait, I kept post here. Cool. If I go to forms.py, not forms.py, sorry. Yeah, this is present. In routes, it is present. Okay, debug is true only. If I think debug is true. Yeah, okay, debug was false. So as you can see, I restarted the application now, right? So if you keep debug true in Flask, you don't have to restart it all the time. That becomes a lot easier. You have to just set the environmental variable in your terminal, or Flask debug equal to 1, This will set the environmental variable flaws, it will set debugging to true, so you don't have to reload, you don't have to restart it again and again, and hopefully not go to more bugs, right? So yeah, so whatever you change here, if I take it out, right, as you can see, it is restarting again whenever I save it. So that's the use of having a debug mode. Whenever I save it, it will restart again, basically. Yeah, so that covers the route part. And coming to what more should I say, edit and delete. Okay, I hope I gave you a clear picture of what is happening, right? How the model is developed, how the database is developed, how the front end is connected to the back end, how the data is transferred. I hope I covered all of those things. If you have any doubts in the process, comment them, because I think these are the main features that anyone should have. Like, you should just, for example, authentication or having cookies and everything comes down to just adding a if statement here. If is equal to current user, right? And change the, just tab this part of the code, and this set of features comes to that user. So that part and the front end part, adding JavaScript and CSS, that's just, you can Google it. You know, this part is where things get more complex as you get, you know, this is just four functions for one operation, but think about different combinations of them, right? So having a clear picture at this scale will help you a lot later on. So coming down to templates, so templates will be the front end, and yeah, edit part. So this is the create part, which will create the post, and this is the explore part. So this is the home page of your code, as you can see, and this is the explore route also is sent to this part. This is just the page where all the posts are shown, right? After this, I'll talk about edit. So as you can see, edit is, once you know create, you'll get to know like all the things are same, almost everything is same. Edit is basically when you create a, you just have to write the ID number of the post that you want to edit, and again it comes down to a form, a model, a form, and again remembering the post ID and just saving it to the database. So it's the same thing, but a little variation is there. I use the same HTML, as I told you, it's cu.html, right? Create and update.html. So the update part I haven't shown you yet. So actually the update part is same, but when you click edit form, it comes as update form. When you click as create form, it comes as create form, right? This part, as I told you, again comes down to the dynamic part of the code, right? The type part of the code is the type, like the create form or the update form. I'm using the same form here. You can use a different form. For example, you can type another form here, class edit post form, but the structure will be same, right? We are editing the same form, so no need of that right now. We are using the same form, same model of the form, like we're using the same model, same form here, because we are talking about one entity. But what will be different is that here we are remembering the post ID, right? We are sending the post ID in the URL. So if you see, when I click edit here, if you see the URL, see, it comes as 2 comma edit. We are editing the second post here. So that dynamic part of the code actually tells which form to edit and everything. This is a simple form to, this is a simple type to relate the post to the edit form. You can use, there's a dynamic form of encoding in your URL. There are lots of different things in URLs actually. you can make it more dynamic and everything. So having that two number helps a lot. Having that post ID number will help you edit it. For example, friends was there. Let's type suits. As you can see, we changed it from friends to suits here. So that is the edit part. And as you told, this is the flash message I was talking about. It's a temporary message. If you reload it, it will be gone. So that's one thing. And edit is basically same as create, as you've seen. The same form, the same thing, everything is same. You just have to send the type here. That's the only difference. And you have to remember the form here. This part is a dynamic part, right? This part is loaded. I'll show you where. Not here, sorry. Sorry, it's loaded in roots only. It's my mistake. Wait. Yeah. Post part of the code. This code is actually the post part. I haven't shown you yet, but this is where the post is shown. So this part, post created, all these posts that you're seeing right now are actually is done by this function, right? What it does is basically, these are all CSS and JavaScript, but what it does is mostly it will print the post ID 3, post title, title, body, and will help give you the edit and delete links. So as you can see here, the links will be quite different here than the normal links which we see normally. So that's the difference between what you call it, the URL for an edit and create functions. So except from this, I guess everything is done. You know, this part is done. Yeah, coming to delete is will be quite obvious by now, I guess, for you. So in post ID delete, whenever you click it will be deleted. Simple. And as you can see, whenever we perform an operation, at the end we are writing return redirect URL for explore, right? So redirect is basically, as the name suggests, you will be redirected to that page. But the important part is URL 4. Instead of writing URL 4, I can write slash explore here to go there. So for example, if I, let's try it, slash explore, it should work. So which one is this? Edit, right? Oh wait, what did I change? Okay, sorry, extra bracket was there. Okay, yeah, whenever you change it, submit, it will work. You'll go back to explore. As you can see, it will work, but this part is better if you keep it as URL4, because the name of the entities changes. Okay, it's not always the route will not always stay explore. So here the explore part is actually the function, not the URL. So the definition, the function definition or the function name changes if you are collaborating with different people. Maybe they want a different name. So instead of changing everywhere, you can just write the function name here so that it is easily called. And you know, it will be directed to the perfect correct page. So yeah, this covers the CRUD operations. Yeah, that's it. This should be good. I hope you people learned something from this. Okay, so this is the second part what I wanted to talk. If I missed anything or if you have any doubts, kindly say. I know this is my first time doing a seminar, so please cut me some slack if I'm not organized. Yeah, I was talking about migrations, right? Migrations is a very important part of code, right? Because migrations comes down to your database, right? It is when you are changing your database model. For example, if you add author here, and this will be a new parameter to your table, right? So if you click, if you type db migrations, if you keep track of the migrations that you have, it will be easier for you to, you know, whenever there's a change in the structure of your schema, it will be easy for you to track them and, you know, update the previous records to the current one and downgrade the current records to the previous one, something like that. You can downgrade the current, for example, if you're using an extra parameter that no one needs, you can downgrade it to the previous migration so that it will be, the difference can be directly affected on the schema itself. You don't have to change each and every record that is already stored in that particular schema. I hope I'm making some sense here. Because, for example, if you created a title and body for now, and later you wanted to add author, right? Then you can add the author and you have to do a DB migration so that later on when you don't need an author or maybe you want another author, you'll have a track of what is happening. If you go to migrations folder and versions, as you can see, there are different versions of code. See the title of the code, posts, update, create table. So there are different types of the migrations that I stored so that what is upgraded, as you can see, this part is upgraded. I have added the author parameter. What is downgraded? This part. So this is what migrations does. It helps you, it makes your job easier when you're dealing with databases and schema, basically. So yeah, that covers the CRUD operations, I think. If you have any doubts, ask me. And yeah, that's it. Let's go back to my slide. Ask your doubts if you have any. Migration, static, VNV, git ignore. Yeah, that's it. So yeah, these are the CRUD operations, as I told you. Coming to deployment options, which everybody wants, right? You want your project to be deployed, and it will be easier for you to share them with your friends or show it in your resume, or, you know, just see how it works in a scalable way. So there are multiple platforms which help you deploy your code. Specific to Flask, they're very Flask friendly, actually. So first one that comes to mind is Heroku, which is a simple one, simple, but it's customizable to your needs, basically. So the one sample, this is the project I created like before the seminar. So yeah, this is the Hello World Flask application, right? The sample part that I did here, I'll show you 1 minute. Yeah, this folder is the basic app.py. Yeah, these 5 lines of code I have shown in the beginning, the same thing I have deployed in Heroku. So anybody with this link, instead of showing it in localhost like here, you can actually see it here. So that makes your project a little bit easier to access and show it to others. Apart from that, there's certain Heroku specific things that you have to do. For example, instead of using the regular server that Flask comes with, you have to use a Gunicorn. I don't know how it is spelled, but it is called Gunicorn, G-U-G-Unicorn. So yeah, so let me go to the virtual environment. This would be interesting to you because you right? So these are the basic packages that are used for deploying your application in Heroku. This is the basic part, but you have to customize it based on your whatever features that you're using. For example, if you're using Postgres and if you're using different services or APIs, you have to change. I'll show you the file which you have to change. So this part, Unicorn. So this is the one we are using to connect with the Heroku server. So what we are deploying in cloud. So yeah, and yeah, only that is required. That is the only dependency apart from the normal Flask part that you're using. So one more thing that you have to use for deploying in Heroku is proc file. This tells the Heroku, you know, server which server you're using, Unicorn, and which app you're using. So the first app is the file name in which your app instance is there, right? In app.py, we have the app instance. App is equal to Flask name. So this calls the, this is used here to show the, it will show the Flask instance to load all the, load the application. And one more thing you have to do is create a requirements.txt file. I hope you guys know about this. It's just a requirements.txt file, whatever are required. So first thing that you have to do is Heroku. You have to also have the Heroku CLI, client interface, like command line interface. So that can be done. Yeah, there are different versions. So just Google it and follow them. For Mac, it was easy. Just Brew. You can use Brew to install it. Ubuntu is also, it's mostly easy, as you can see. But yeah. This, after you having, after you have Heroku, the first command you have to hit is Heroku create and your app name. It can be, as I wrote, sample 1100. Then the URL will be sample110.herokuapp.com, right? So yeah, that will, and your app name must be unique whenever you're using Heroku. That's another thing. These domains are free, so you have to comply with the rules. And of course, is Flask used really large projects? Flask are used in decently large, it can be used in medium to large projects. Based on the cloud options that you have, it can be used in medium to large projects. That the projects that I have worked on, which had 2 million users, used Flask. So that is a decent scale. Yeah. So yeah, you have to create the app first. I have created it. It will take time, so that's why I'm not showing here. Basically, Heroku create app, random app 1 to 1 to 1. Oh, sorry, I wrote create app. Yeah. So it will be creating like this. Oh, it is created. Cool. So this thing is created. And one more thing is Heroku works with your Git, right? So your whole project must be in GitHub to be able to. So the sample thing that I shown you, right? First I had to upload it to GitHub and link it to Heroku. It's pretty easy. At the end, you just have to git push Heroku master. That's it. This will push all the code that you did. As you can see, everything's update now, up to date. But whenever you make any changes and you want to show it in your cloud, you can show it in like this, just Heroku master. Just you have to push it in Heroku master. That's it. So this is how you can do it in Heroku. This is one. You can all domains are free, I guess, up to I don't know how many files, but it is mostly free. Apart from this, I told you about Python Anywhere. Python Anywhere is more beginner friendly, if you ask me. It's just that you have to upload your files there. Basically speaking, you just have to upload your whole project into their server, and instead of running writing Flask run in your laptop, you just have to open their link. That's it. As you go. Log in here. Okay, I don't know. Wait, my login details, I don't remember, but yeah, basically this is how it works. Yeah, I'm logged in here. So if you go to files, this is very beginner friendly. Whoever want to do it properly, you should do it in Heroku. So yeah, I can see Flaskred is the app, and all the files that I were in my file, I kept it here. Python anywhere is not that not advisable for people who want to do it properly. So yeah, Heroku is much better. So that covers the deployment options. If you ask me, there are many others. Actually speaking, there's GitLab. GitLab also gives their domain after your after your app name, your app.gitlab.com.org/com, I don't remember, but yeah, GitLab also provides you with those things. I guess that covers the deployment options and everything that we have. And coming to the end, open source contributions, right? So let me tell you, the Flask that we do from learning these tutorials and, you know, building some projects, it's all nice. You will build a project, you will get to know how it works and everything, but to actually deploy it in large scale, right, to deploy with hundreds of thousands of users, you should have a team of people, and you should be able to work on it in real time, where there are end users who are using it, and you will be able to learn the true power of the framework. Not only in Flask, but in any framework specifically, you'll be able to learn how a framework actually works in huge scale, what servers are used on, how it is customized according to other needs, and how it is connected to a different front end and back end, how a back end API is connecting to different, different things like mobile Android or web application, something like that. So what are the benefits that I can think of are, you know, you'll get to meet new people like Codalplex. This is a community. Similarly, all open source communities are welcoming of new people who are interested to, you know, contribute, and you'll be able to clarify your doubts almost in a daily basis. Like if you are part of a very active community, they will clarify your doubts, and you'll be able to learn a lot of new things. For example, when I started, I did not know what was PPH standard, right? I hope you guys know it. But PPH standard is kind of a big deal when you're writing professional like Python code, right? It must be properly done. My merge request, like my pull request, were denied just because my PPH standards weren't good. And yeah, there's also pre-commit function in GitHub, which I didn't know before contributing. Like it, you can run certain amount of commands to see if your commit is good. I also got to know about continuous integration, evaluation, CI/CD, and yeah, all these new things like Travis CLI, yeah, everything I got to know about open source through open source. So I would recommend everyone to, you know, join whichever project that you like, whichever community that you like, whichever, it can be on anything. It can be on your interest, or it can be on your, the technical stack, tech stack that you're using. So based on that, you can choose a project. Currently I'm part of MetaBrains community. It is a really nice community. It is very active. All the developers are very active, and they almost chat every day in the week in the IRC. So whoever is interested, kindly come here, come to these links, you know, go through these links, come by our IRC and, you know, talk with us. MetaBrains also uses Flask, has Flask projects. So yeah, they are scalable. They are actually scaled around 2 lakh users. They have 2 lakh users. So that is pretty scalable. So you can work, you can get to work on those projects. And yeah, apart from this, these are the resources that I would recommend anyone. See, I just covered the basics, and these people can teach even better than me. So if you want to proceed further in Flask, I would recommend Mega Flask Tutorial blog. Right, this is one of the best blogs. It's free and it's one of the best blogs that you can go through. It covers all the topics, as you can see, from Hello World to templates, web forms, databases, pagination, error handling. Basically, if you complete this, you can say you're an intermediate Flask developer. It goes through the API part as well. So yeah, you can go through this. This is not in video format. This is basically in text format, like blocks, a series of blocks. So if you don't want to do this, you can go for this guy's playlist. His playlist is also very good. You'll get to know a lot of things. Right, he has a Django and Flask, both of them. So you can go through any one of them. There are 15 videos and 17 videos. So you'll understand basics. Like, you'll be an intermediate developer in Flask. You can call yourself an intermediate developer. And obviously, if you have any other doubts, you can go to the Flask official documentation page. It pretty much clears everything, whatever doubts that you have. And Stack Overflow and Reddit, these things you already know, right? So yeah, these are the things which are useful for you. These resources are really nice. As I told you, after learning these resources, you will be able to build an application which is local to your host and not that scalable. You can't replicate how it happens in the real world, right? What problems that you face. That's why I recommend you to go through any open source community. MetaBrains, for example, if you go to the GitHub project, they have many projects here. These are all backend projects, Flask based. So you can go to any one of this community is based on open source music, basically a transparent music based platform. The different types of projects around that topic. So if you are interested, you can go there. Yeah. Or any other community that you like. I was part of FOSS Asia before this. That was also a really nice experience. Yeah, this is another Flask application, Open Event Server. As you can see, this uses Flask as its web framework. It's a very useful, it is an open server. Open event server. How do I call it? It's the server part of an application called Open Event. Like, it's an open source version of Meetup, which you usually use in Codalplex. It's just an open sourced version of it. So, no need to pay anything, no need to do anything. It's the backend part of it. There's an Android app for this and everything. I actually did commit for this long back ago. 2 months back ago, I think I committed. It's not there, I guess. Yeah. As you can see, if you're part of open source community, you'll be knowing different types of codes. You know, what are the structures, different types of technologies, like different positions. I did testing part of the code. As you can see, these are all testing. You can even add documentation to it. They're all different things. As you can see, most of my codes are merged. So if your code is merged, that means they will use it later on when they're going for the next version. So that's how you get to know, what is the standard, which technology to use, how to scale it. So yeah, that's it. That concludes my session. I think I covered most of them. I hope you learned something. Yep. Thank you for staying with me this long. and these are the extra links. If you want to, you know, catch up with me or follow me, this is my LinkedIn, GitHub, blog, and the source code of this project, you can have it as well. It's in GitHub. So yeah, thank you for sticking with me. If you have any doubts, kindly ask me. I'll stay for another 2-3 minutes, or if you don't have anything, cool, that's okay. Thank you for listening to me. Okay guys, I guess everybody or no one has any doubts. Is it possible to connect to cloud? Yeah. Okay, to be able to connect to cloud, you can connect to cloud. That's another thing, like you can host your application in AWS and everything. That's a different thing. Yeah. Yeah, okay then guys, thank you for listening to me. I'll be going.